Well, good morning. You're also welcome to Movilla Abbey Church, and a special welcome if you're joining us for the first time or if you're returning after a while. We hope that this will feel like home today. And if you're joining us online, you are so welcome. Hopefully, you'll be able to be with us in person soon. It's great when we gather to have that noise and chatter and the noise of people of different ages coming in. It's amazing because God's family, the church, is for all ages, isn't it? It's for all personality types. It's for all walks of life. And we gather together because we want to share what God is doing in us and through us. And we find that when we worship together, we meet with God. So can I say thank you for being here, for making the choice to be here, and prioritizing gathered worship, because there are more and more things, aren't there? There's more and more things that try and claim this time. There's more and more things in our lives that try and claim this hour and a half that we have together. And we want to prioritize gathering the worship, because when we gather, we're blessed by one another, aren't we? Aren't we? If you were here by yourself for this, it'd be really different than if you're surrounded by all these people. Scripture tells us this: when you draw near to God, God draws near to you. Can we say that together? When you draw near to God, God draws near to you. Isn't that amazing? Because as I take maybe a very tentative little step to talk to God or connect with God in some way, God has already taken a huge leap to connect with me. So as we gather, as we worship together, we're just going to do what we usually do on a Sunday. We're going to begin by celebrating who God is. There'll be some time to be honest with God about the state of our hearts. Then we're going to hear from Scripture, and then we're going to respond to what we've heard. How does that sound? And we want to say at the beginning that, as always, this is a safe place to worship God, however you feel led. So if you want to stand and sing with your hands raised high, this is the place for that. Or if you want to sit in stillness and quietness, this is the place for that. That's all fine here. If you use spiritual gifts in worship, like tongues, we want you to be comfortable to do that here. Whatever helps you to give God your best in worship. Remember, when you draw near to God, God draws near to you. As we take small little steps to connect with God, God has already made the greatest effort to connect with us. A few announcements. Next week, Sunday the 30th, it's our annual church meeting. So that's a chance to reflect on the year past and to look to the year ahead. We're also going to be doing some of the really practical things of our life together. A chance for you to look at our finances and hear what's going on with property here. And importantly, together we will ratify the election of our new leadership team formed back in October. So that means next Sunday at 11, it'll be our usual worship time. Then at some stage, the cameras will go off and we'll do a little bit of business before wrapping it all up in worship. And you're all welcome. Next announcement. We're announcing this because not everyone seems to have heard about this yet, okay? So we want to make sure everyone knows what's going on. Today at 3 p.m., the UK government are testing out a new emergency alert system, which is intended to be used in the case of life-threatening weather events and things like that. So what it means is that today, anyone who's got a smartphone, your smartphone is going to beep. It's going to vibrate, I think, for 10 seconds. So if that happens, do not panic. I understand there's going to be some instructions appearing on your smartphone screen. You just press a button and apparently it goes away. So if there's someone you know who you know struggles with technology, today might be a day to get in touch and make sure they're going to be okay with this. And if you're someone who struggles with technology, maybe you want to lift a phone to someone in your life who doesn't, and they can talk you through it. Okay. Since September, we've been making space for quiet, contemplative worship, and you're very welcome to join. 7 p.m. tonight in the Strangford Room, and 11 a.m. on a Wednesday, while coffee shop's all going on, we gather for 30 minutes or so in the Strangford Room and we share communion together, and we'd love to see you. Prayer. Prayer is happening in lots of places in the life of Movilla Abbey Church. People are praying in their life groups. There's prayer every other Thursday evening in the Strangford Room. There's various prayer groups meeting in houses and so on. So plenty of opportunities to gather and pray together. Want to just let you know about one more that's just started, and that's at 7:30 a.m. 7:30 in the morning, every Wednesday in the Strangford Room. So if none of those other times are working for you, maybe you want to get up a little early, or maybe that's not early for you, but you want to get here and join in prayer. That is an invitation if you want to join. Now, can we stand together? And let's prepare to celebrate who Jesus is, what Jesus has done. Johnny, are you able to play through this psalm? Would that be okay? Yeah. As we prepare to worship, let's not wait to be warmed up, or let's not wait till we hear that one song that we really like. Let's choose to engage with God as we worship. When you draw near to God, God draws near to you. Let's say it together. When you draw near to God, God draws near to you.
Some words from Psalm 145. I will praise you, my God and King, and always honor your name. I will praise you each day and always honor your name. You're wonderful, Lord. Yep. And you deserve all praise, because you're much greater than anyone can understand. Each generation will announce to the next your wonderful and powerful deeds. I will keep thinking about your marvelous glory and your mighty miracles. Everyone will talk about your fearsome deeds, and I will tell all nations how great you are. They will celebrate and sing about your matchless mercy and your power to save.
Wonderful, so wonderful is your unfailing love. Your cross has spoken mercy over me. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no heart can fully know how glorious, how beautiful. So powerful, your glory fills the sky. captured my heart with your wonders anew. You've captured my heart with your love. 'Cause nothing on earth is as beautiful as you. You've opened my eyes to the wonders anew. You've captured my heart with your love.
Beautiful one.
Beautiful one, I love you. Beautiful one, I adore. Beautiful one, my soul must sing. My soul must sing. My soul must sing. My soul must sing. Beautiful, my soul must sing. My soul must sing. My soul must sing. Beautiful one, I love you. Beautiful one, I adore. Beautiful one, my.
Lord, blessed be your name.
Times and the bad times, and we know that we are not so faithful. We are fickle. We follow Jesus one moment and then turn away the next. Our hearts are prone to rebellion and self-interest, but God longs to heal us, to forgive us, to set us right again. As we turn away from our wickedness, as we turn away from our selfishness, as we turn again towards Jesus in his loving way. There are going to be some words on the screen, an ancient prayer of the church that acknowledges our sinfulness before God and asks for forgiveness and healing. And you can join in this prayer or pray in your own way. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness and keep us in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Held by you in harmony, yourself, your perfect plan. It's all for your glory, Almighty God, in every way. You are above and beyond understanding. If we did not praise, the rocks would cry out, glory.
Today you're gathering here and you're feeling like you're only just here, you know, like you're only just still hanging on. And if that's where you are today, I'm reminded of how Jesus gathered all his followers in an upper room, a group of people in all different states of heart and mind, you remember? People just like us. And he said to them, I no longer call you servants, I call you friends. Jesus says, I no longer call you servants, I call you friends. What an amazing privilege that the God of the universe, the maker of all things, calls you friend today. So as the kids team go out just now, and we're preparing our hearts to hear the words of Jesus, the words of one who calls us friends, one who loves us, one who has something to say to us today, something that will mean that tomorrow is different from tomorrow is different from yesterday. So let's listen to the words of our friend Jesus. The kids team are going to go out that way. Alan's going to come up. You guys can take your seats if you haven't already. Just a reminder, please feel totally comfortable to sit down. If those times of worship are too long for you, please feel comfortable to sit down. No one's looking at you, okay? So feel safe in that space to do that. Where is Alan? He's somewhere. He's racing to the front even now. Lord, just as we come to listen to you, thank you that you call us friends. So Lord, may we hear from you in that place of friendship as Alan comes and opens the scriptures to us. Lord, we know you have something to say to us. We are listening. Amen.
Good morning. Good morning. Well, listen, before I begin, I'm used to standing up here on the platform, but in less than 2 weeks' time, I'm going to be standing just down there with Jill as we get married. And I wish we'd eloped to Gretna Green with all of the stuff that's been happening over the last few weeks, but I'm so looking forward to it. And I just want to remind you that you are all invited. You may want to stay at home and watch the King's coronation, which of course, please do if that's what you want to do with your day. But if you want to come and join us here at 12:30 and be part of our marriage service, we would love to celebrate our union with you, our church family. So that's an open invitation to come and join us at the service. And have some brief refreshments afterwards. Now, open your Bibles with me. If you haven't got a Bible app on your phone, or if you have got that, you can open. We're looking at John 21 today. If you've got a pew Bible in front of you, turn to page 1090 and 1091. In a moment, Emma's going to come and read for us, but first some words of introduction. So we come today to the final chapter of our careful 8-month journey together through the story of the good news of Jesus Christ. as witnessed firsthand, remembered, shared, and written by John. John, of course, was one of Jesus' earliest disciples, one of his hand-picked 12 apostles, a Jewish Galilean fisherman who, along with his brother and fishing partner James, was so inspired by the person, the words, and the actions of Jesus that he left his job and his hometown to go all in with the one he came to realize was not just the son of Mary and Joseph, but the Son of God himself. And near the end of his life, having almost certainly read Matthew, Mark, and Luke's accounts that were probably circulating around the early church for a decade or two before, in about AD 80 is the best guess of a lot of theologians, probably in his late 70s, John also decides to put quill to parchment. Now, some of you may want to ask why it took so long for Jesus' followers to write their accounts. If you think about it, I think the answer is obvious. Those first Jewish Jesus followers, who were likely in their 20s or 30s when Jesus ministered, after Jesus' resurrection, death and resurrection, and his subsequent empowering of them by his Holy Spirit, they spent the next 30 years, if they weren't killed by angry fellow Jews or hostile Romans, actually doing the work Jesus gave them to do, of leading and growing God's new family, the church. They didn't have time to write books. They were recounting every day their experience of Jesus in word and in practice, in the face of opposition, to everyone of that generation they possibly could, so that they could come to know Jesus too. But to cut a long story short, out of concern for generations to come, John finds space and time to write his account. Now, maybe it took months or years to finish. Maybe he kept coming back to it. I don't know. But whatever, in his very final words, referring to his carefully chosen selection of what Jesus said and did in his 3 years of ministry before returning to heaven, John concludes with these wonderfully tantalizing words. And I want you to look at them on page 1091 if you've got your pew Bibles, verse 25. Jesus did many other things as well. If every one of them were written down, I suppose that even the whole world would not have room for the books that would be written. It's a lovely, human, museful sentence, but it's important because John wants us to know, wants you to know, that his account of Jesus, if you've read it, is not meant to be definitively exhaustive as a record of all that Jesus said and did. His account was the last to be written, and almost certainly because he was, as I say, familiar with the other accounts, he knew he wanted to tell the story of Jesus from a very different angle. He wanted to be very selective in what events and words he chose to record. And he had a very specific reason for that. He tells us at the end of his penultimate chapter, you can see it for yourself, top left if you've got the pew Bible, verse 30 and 31 there. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written. Why? That you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. I want you to hear this. In other words, John is not interested in giving you knowledge about the Jesus who lived in the past. He wants you to come and know Jesus who lives personally in the present. He's not concerned that you have all the information about Jesus and what he did, but that in knowing him, you may have transformation from him now, in the present. For John, what Jesus did in those 3 years is not the main reason for his writing, and does not want it to be for your reading. John is more interested in what Jesus may do in you right now, if you will allow him, that you may have life in his name. So here's the big question. Do you? Do you have life, fullness of life in his name from him? Now let's listen together to this final chapter, chapter 21, and you can follow it in your pew Bibles or whatever you're using as Emma comes to read for us.
Afterwards, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. "I'm going out to fish," Simon Peter told them, and they said, "We'll go with you." So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not recognize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" "No," they answered. He said, "Throw your net onto the right side of the boat and you'll find some." When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from the shore, about 100 meters. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you've just caught." So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. It was full of fish, 153. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus had appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said, "you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him a third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted, but when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go." Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, "Follow me." Peter turned and saw that the disciple whom Jesus loved was following them. This was the one who had leaned his back against Jesus at the Last Supper and had said, "Lord, who is going to betray you?" When Peter saw him, he asked, "Lord, what about him?" Jesus answered, "If I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? You must follow me." Because of this, the rumor spread among the believers that this disciple would not die. But Jesus did not say that he would not die. He only said, "If I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you?" This is the disciple who testifies to these things and who wrote them down. We know that his testimony is true. Jesus did many other things as well. If every one of them were written down, I suppose that even the whole world would not have room for the books that could be written. Amen.
Remind you again of John's reason for telling us all that he's told us. These are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. Now, over the centuries, many artists have tried to capture this amazing scene of the risen Jesus on a Galilean beach, calling across the water to his disillusioned disciples in their boat. Rubens and Raphael have both painted pictures called The Miraculous Draught of Fishes, but my favourite, of which I have a signed print on my wall at home, actually is this one. I hope we can get a picture up of it now. By English artist John Riley, who died aged 81 earlier this year. And if that's great. We've got that on the screen for everybody to see at home on the full screen. We'll leave this image up until I finish. And without interpreting it too much, I just want you to, if you drift off from what I'm saying, look at the picture, and to notice from where and whom the source and flow of life comes. Okay. Now, for the folks at home, let's put that back in the background. We'll keep it up on the main screens here in church so that you can see it here. In this final chapter, John brings his whole carefully chosen selection of Jesus' words and actions to a thrilling and challenging climax where Jesus literally hosts a barbecue for his friends on the beach. John tells us in verse 14 that this is the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after his resurrection, though John may mean it was the third time where he was present, because even by John's record, it's his fourth appearance, including Mary Magdalene. And Jesus appears in the ordinariness of everyday life. Jesus appears in the ordinariness of simple daily jobbing life. And I love this because it tells me that you or I do not necessarily need to do extraordinary things to meet with Jesus. Jesus will meet with you wherever you are today. Peter, well, he's fishing. Six of the disciples have joined him, and Jesus tells them where to catch fish and then cooks breakfast for them. Here is Jesus risen from the dead, the one through whom the whole universe came into being, that's what John begins his gospel with, saying to his friends, come and have breakfast. As someone put it, the God who is revealed in Jesus Christ is life-affirming and such fun. He really is. And don't miss that Jesus has chosen to welcome and feed them over a charcoal fire. Now, in John's gospel, can you recall where we last saw a charcoal fire? Yeah? Shout it out if you know. Pilate's courtyard. Yes, that's right. In the courtyard of Caiaphas, the high priest, near where Pilate was, where Peter, the supposedly most passionate and devoted follower of Jesus, remember in chapter 13, John records Peter had insisted loudly and emphatically he would be loyal to Jesus to the point of death. There, at that pre-dawn fire in that courtyard, Peter had warmed himself as he denied his association with Jesus. Not once, but three times. Now this is no random coincidence. Jesus doesn't do random coincidence. He always has a loving purpose in everything he does with us. And at this second charcoal fire, it's amazing how smells are reminiscent, isn't it? Jesus questions Peter. Not once, but three times. One time for every rejection comes an offer of reconciliation. As Tom Wright suggests, this scene between Jesus and Peter is one of the most spectacular interchanges in the whole Bible, perhaps in all literature, he suggests. It's that important, forgiveness and reconciliation. Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you truly love me more than these? Now, the reference to these may refer to his fishing gear or the other disciples. But whatever it means, Jesus was calling Peter to make his love for Jesus his supreme love. Our love for Jesus should be more than our love for anything else. But Peter had denied Jesus three times. So Jesus gives him the opportunity to reaffirm his love three times. Three times Peter tells Jesus, I love you. But the most remarkable thing about this exchange, as Tom Wright comments, is that by way of forgiveness, Jesus gives Peter a job to do. When Peter seizes on Jesus' question of his love for him by professing his devotion with the smell of that charcoal fire still in his nostrils, Jesus doesn't just say, well, that's okay then. He says, well, feed my lambs. Look after my sheep. Feed my sheep. The penitent man who has broken the trust of Jesus is not rejected. And he's not rejected and told he can never be trusted again. Instead, he is entrusted with more. Isn't this grace? And Jesus hints to Peter that his professed love for him and by implication for his church, that Jesus is now asking him to help him care for. Remember that Jesus referred to himself as the good shepherd who would gather those sheep who respond to his voice into his fold, John chapter 10, that Peter's acceptance of this new task that he's giving him is going to be costly. Indeed, it would cost Peter his life. John tells us that Jesus says to him, when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. And John specifically says, Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. This is the earliest evidence for the martyrdom of Peter by crucifixion. To be a lover and a follower of Jesus is a wonderful but dangerous undertaking. And then Jesus simply says to Peter, follow me. Now when Peter is told this, he turns and he sees John hanging around. And he asks about his future. In this intimate moment with Jesus, Peter is distracted by comparison with John. And Jesus politely tells him to mind his own business. And that's something worth remembering when we're tempted to compare ourselves with others. By way of reply and a reminder of his redemptive offer, Jesus says again, you must follow me. This scene reminds me of a scene in C.S. Lewis's Narnia Chronicles, which I've read so many times. I love them. In the book The Horse and His Boy, where near the climax of that story, a girl named Aravis, who, like all of us, has been hurt by others, but also caused hurt to others, meets the lion Aslan, the Christ figure, if you like, in the Narnia series. And in her exchange with Aslan, she has to confront not only him, but herself and her broken past. The hurt done to her and the hurt she has done to others. And that needs dealing with. And at one point, Aravis asks the lion about another girl who is standing nearby. And Aslan answers, child, I am telling you your story, not hers. No one is told any story but their own. I am telling you your story. Follow me. That's a paraphrase of what Jesus says to Peter. And this is Jesus' offer to each one of us. I am telling you your story. Follow me. This is Jesus' offer to each one of us for our own personal story of failure. I wonder, what's your story? And will you allow Jesus to change it for the good? That's the question that John is implicitly asking in this final chapter. You see, John began his gospel on a cosmic scale, didn't he? Revealing to us that Jesus was and is none other than God himself, the one who gave beginning to all things, revealed in personal, knowable human flesh. And John hammers this all-encompassing cosmic message about Jesus home throughout his book. A few examples here. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, John the Baptist declares. God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, Nicodemus learns. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God who has come into the world, Martha proclaims. And John tells us that even the unbelieving religious leaders unwittingly saw the cosmic significance of this Jesus. Look how the whole world has gone after him. Now, it is one thing and a vital thing to see and to believe that Jesus is for the world. But it will mean nothing for you unless you come to see and believe that Jesus is for you as well. It's one thing to believe that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. It's quite another to believe that God so loved you that he gave his one and only son. But this, friends, is the deeply personal challenge that John lays before all of us, even you today. These things are written that you, forget the person next to you, these things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. Now, I think that is one of the reasons why John decides to finish his gospel account with this deeply personal story of Peter's rescue by Jesus. Through the lens, if you like, of Peter's deeply personal, broken story and its renewal by Jesus, John wants us all to see our broken stories and that they and we can be remade and renewed and given and entrusted with something new. Now, I don't know if Peter had a good or broken relationship with his father growing up, but I think it's fascinating that Jesus says to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Did you notice that instead of calling him Peter, the new name that he'd given him when he first chose to follow Jesus 3 years before, Jesus here addresses him as Simon. He uses the name given to him by his parents and mentions his father by connection with him. In other words, he's reminding him of his story from the beginning. Alan, son of Barbara and Peter, do you love me? I hear Jesus ask in these words. What about you and your story from birth and through life? Michael, son of Phil, son of Barbara, daughter of Deborah, daughter of. Insert your name and your personal story, whether it's good or bad. The story of the person next to you is not for you to know unless they choose to reveal it. What about you? Jesus asks, do you love me? Will you follow me? It doesn't matter how much you've been hurt and how much hurt you yourself have caused, or how long ago all that was. There is a way forward. And though you may not feel worthy of it, Jesus has new and important things for you to do in life, however long you have left. But in this moment, you're going to have to choose. These things are written that you may believe and have life. I am telling you your story, and in it, I love you, Jesus is saying. Do you love me? Will you follow me? As I said a moment ago, forgiveness and reconciliation are of vital importance. This is the heart of the gospel, and it's the only thing really in life that matters. It's why Jesus spoke to Peter on that beach in the spring of 33 AD, and friends, it's why Jesus is here this morning in this place, and He is speaking to you. He's speaking to you, addressing you by name. And he always wants to give us a chance to respond, to be restored, to be healed, and to have life in his name. And Michael is going to come and explain now how we can do that in a very simple way this morning and respond to Jesus' offer of restoration and healing and receive all that he wants to give us.
So we want to spend some time simply responding to what we've heard from Jesus. The band are going to play, and you can use the words of the songs to speak to Jesus, or you can use this space just to be quiet and still in Jesus' presence and just listen. And as before, you're free to stand with hands raised high or to sit in stillness or to find a space and lie face down if that's what you need to do. Ken and Ruth are going to be over here. You guys can move now, thank you. They've got some anointing oil. And so if you want to come at any point and receive that sign of blessing, they'll just anoint you with oil. They can anoint your forehead or your hands, whichever you prefer. And they'll just pray God's blessing on you. Or if you want to share something more specific, confidentially, for yourself or someone else, Ken and Ruth are here to do that, okay? This is your time now to respond to Jesus. Again, don't feel like you got to stay standing the whole time. You can sit if you want, but we'll stand now to signal our intention that we're going to engage with God. And I want you to notice how it is that Jesus speaks to Peter. Jesus had every right to come scolding and accusing. Jesus had every right to remind Peter of the things that he'd done wrong, but he doesn't. He just makes breakfast on the beach. And in that place of friendship, he speaks to Peter gently. He asks Peter questions that challenge him, and he commissions him again for the task that he's called to do. So let this be a breakfast on the beach moment for you and Jesus. As we sing, hear Jesus' invitation to you. Come and have breakfast with me. Come and be with me. Be my friend. Let me speak to you about who you are. Let me restore you. Let me challenge you. Let me be with you.
Jesus, I love you. I love you.
Jesus, I love you. I love you. Your name is like honey on my lips. Your spirit like water to my soul. Your word is a lamp unto my feet. Jesus, I love you. I love you.
People have been praying for us today, and as they've been praying for us, God has shared a few pictures with them, and that's something that the New Testament would have us expect to happen in worship. And so if God speaks to people in pictures and it's for everyone, it's our job to weigh and test whether this is right for us or not. So please hear what's been shared, and if this is for you, then receive it and deal with that in prayer, and maybe come and get prayer. And the first picture is this. It's the fact that in football, it is an important season in football right now. It's the end of the season, and now is the time when football teams are urgent to get business done. They are fighting right now. Football teams are fighting to get what they want. To get the best place that they can get. And an important part of that is the meetings that are going to take place face to face. And so if that speaks to you, that suppose the picture is that now is a season for being urgent, having a sense of urgency about meeting with God, having a sense of urgency about getting that business done, about meeting face to face with God. And so if that resonates with you, I encourage you just to continue to pray into that as we worship, or come and seek prayer here at the front for that. And the second thing I want to share is just the picture of a story Jesus tells of the father who has two sons. Do you remember the story? And one of them goes off and betrays the father. But at the end of the story, there's the elder brother, the brother who was left behind, who was faithfully serving the father for years. And when at the end of the story, when he sees the father dancing and celebrating for the return of this arrogant, sinful son, he is hurt. He is offended. He is angry. He feels that he's been left in the shadows, and he says, "Why are you having a party? What about me?" And the father draws close to his offended and hurt son, and he speaks these words of restoration to him that maybe are words that we need to hear today. The father says this, "My son, you are always with me. And all I have is yours." And so if you're in that place of being angry or offended or hurt, or if you're looking at others and saying, "God, why are you doing that for them but not for me?" Hear this word from the Father today. My son. My daughter. You are always with me. And all I have is yours. Be reminded of your place. May those words of God sink deep into your heart today. I'm going to sing one more song.
Stand at all.
first verse again. Let my yes be yes.
Let my yes be yes to you, O Lord. Let my no be no to the things of this world. If I rise or fall, if I stand at all, I am leaning on your everlasting arms. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, what a priceless gift. God, I'm yours if you are mine. Let my restless soul be still and know I am leaning on your everlasting arms. I am leaning on your everlasting arms. From the morning sun and mercies new to the evening stars, every promise is true. As I walk this world, I'm held by you. I am leaning on your everlasting arms. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, what a priceless gift. God, I'm yours and you are mine. Let my restless soul be still and know I am leaning on your everlasting arms. I am leaning on your everlasting arms. The more I'm leaning, the more I'm flying, feels less like dying, more like living for heaven on earth. The more I'm leaning, the more I'm flying, feels less like dying, more like living for heaven on earth. The more I'm leaning, the more I'm flying, feels less like dying, more like living for heaven on earth. For heaven on earth. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, what a priceless gift. God, I'm yours and you are mine. Let my restless soul be still and know I am on your everlasting arms. I am leaning on your everlasting arms.
Jesus tells Peter, feed my sheep, feed my lambs. Jesus trusts Peter with an important task, caring for others. It's the work of Jesus, but Jesus wants to use Peter to do it. It's the work of Jesus, but Jesus is going to equip Peter to do it. So for those of us who have said yes to Jesus already, Jesus trusts you with others. Jesus trusts you with that work. So we're going to continue in worship, and if you're still coming up for anointing and prayer, you can keep coming. But we're gonna continue worshiping as we pray for our world. And so if you're more comfortable sitting or kneeling as we pray for our world, you can do that now. And we're remembering that changing the world is the work of Jesus, but that Jesus invites us to partner in this work. Jesus trusts you to partner in this work. So Lord, as we pray, we call to mind the places and the people to which you've sent us. Our offices, our schools, our homes, our families, our friendship circles. Call them to mind now. And we pray for those people, Lord, that they will come to know what friendship with God means. And we pray, Lord, that we will see those places that you've put us. We pray that we would see them becoming more like you would have them be. Your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. And Lord, we pray for those today who are suffering in body, mind, and spirit. And maybe now just call into your mind some people that you know here suffering. And Lord, would they know you drawing alongside them? Would you be their companion right now, their comforter, and their healer? And Jesus, we pray for ourselves. We know that we're messed up, that we are works in progress. And Lord, that we need you. We need you every hour. We need you. And so we invite you to be at work in our lives, working through us even now. And I feel I want to lead us in praying the family prayer together. And if it's okay for today, I want to pray the traditional form with the thys and thous, if that's okay. So let's gather our prayers up as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Let's stand.
Final song is How Can I Keep From Singing?
There is an endless song echoes in my soul. I hear the music ring, and though the storms may come, I am holding on to the cross. I cling. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my want to sing. I will lift my eyes in the darkest night, for I know my Savior lives, and
Lord Jesus, thank you that you come and meet with us as friends. Thank you for the work that you're doing in our hearts right now and that you're going to continue to do. Lord, we say we are yours. Have your way in us today. Have your way in us tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. and Tuesday and right through the week. Let us be your people as we follow you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. We want to say that if for any reason you didn't want to come forward for prayer, Ken and Ruth are going to be around now, so you can come and find them. There's tea and coffee out here, and you're very welcome back for a sort of quiet, contemplative, liturgical worship tonight at 7. I'm just going to invite Alan to come and say a few bits and then bless us as we go.
Yeah, I think I just want to add to what Michael has said there too. Don't think this is the end of an opportunity to meet with the Lord. He knows your story and he loves you and he wants to redeem your story. And we're going to be offering more opportunities for prayer ministry in the coming weeks in our gathered worship because we believe that's important. We believe that it's important that we meet with Jesus to find life in his name. It's about you. It's not about the person next to you. But don't forget that Jesus meets you in the ordinariness of your daily life. And as you go from this place, Jesus goes with you. And he'll be there for you this week, whatever you've got ahead of you this week. And his resources and his grace are enough. And feel free to come back and to bring a friend next week. We'd love to see you back here next week. Let's remind ourselves of these words of John, his purpose for writing. These things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. I just want to finish with some words from Jude, if I can find it here. There we go, just before Revelation. Now, to him who is able to keep us from stumbling and to present us before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God, our Saviour, be glory, majesty, power, and authority. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us, go with us, and remain with us this day and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Amen.